it wouldn't matter. I would have been caught up. I got friends of mine who up in Jackson will never get out of prison.
Amen.
Why? Because they killed some people.
Uh-huh.
But see, when I was I had a situation in my own life. When I was growing up,
yeah, sure
I ended up going to jail.
Sure did.
I was out hanging with my friends.
Right.
I was in the multitude.
Right.
Hanging with my friends. I was hanging with my crew. On the east side, yeah, I was one of the east side guys when I was younger, before I came over to the west side and started living on the west side in the latter part of my life. But I'm telling you now, when I was on the east side, man, we used to get into some stuff. When I was on the east side, one summer day, it was late at night, about six of us. We had it down. We knew we was down. We was like, yeah, you know, all of us little knuckleheads out there doing what we do. So we was walking down, we was by Alter Road. And there was a little fishing store on the corner. Fishing store, yeah, they sold tackle, bait, and all this other kind of stuff. There was a little fishing store on the corner. And when we was just walking through the neighborhood, because you know the east side, we didn't go past one or two blocks past Alter Road, because that was Gross Point. When you got to Gross Point, the white folks wasn't letting you come in.
I'm just telling it like it is.
They wasn't letting you come in. And then when the police saw you, you best believe you gonna get arrested.
Amen.
So we didn't go past that. We walked by this building. I went by that building many times. Walking by the building, we looked at it. We was like, okay. We was walking by. We looked at the sign. We was like, whoa, the door gone. The door was gone on the side of the store.
Amen.
We was like, but stuff was still in it. We was like, okay, we didn't break in, so let's go in and see what we can get.
Set up.
So It was a setup. But see, the setup wasn't by no people, the setup was by the devil.
Yes. Amen.
The devil was setting us up.
Yes.
See, because what we didn't understand was, is, you know, we all up in there trying to, you know, see what we can get. It really wasn't nothing to get, because whoever had broken in had already gotten whatever they wanted to get, and it was gone. And we the little knuckleheads following behind them, trying to see what we can get, trying to, you know, if I can, you know, trying to scrape and, you know, see what we can get. Wasn't nothing in there. But guess what? When we came out, all of a sudden, about three, four police cars come surrounding the place. We like, what? What's going on? So we standing there all little creep. We wasn't even, some of us were teenagers and some of them wasn't even teenagers.
Amen.
At the time, I wasn't even a teenager.
Amen, that's true.
I wasn't even a teenager. But I was like, wow. I'm like, I'm standing there. I'm supposed to be the one on the outside looking out. If the police come in. And I'm looking out, I'm like, and you know, I'm like, before I could even open my mouth, police car was already in the driveway.
Right.
I'm like, yo! So I'm just standing here. And I looked. Now, officer, you're right, I didn't tell you that, Mom. That ain't what I told you back then, but this is what happened. This is a true story. That's a true story. That's what happened that day. I'm standing there on the lookout, supposed to be on the lookout. But, you know, like I said, we didn't break into the place. We didn't break into the place, but we went in the place. We went in, and that day, I was standing there, and I'm like, wow, I'm getting in trouble for nothing. That's right, sister. For nothing, I'm getting in trouble for nothing, because I'm like, okay, I was with my crew, and the police swooped down on us and got us. Because it's something we didn't even do. Because just like we people do in the day, we justified our wrong with the fact that we didn't, quote unquote, break in. All I did was walk in. But see, that's right. But by the time I walked in, it had already been broken in. So guess what? I wasn't no better than the person who broke in, because I still went in somewhere I wasn't supposed to be in. Why? Because I had gotten caught up in the multitude. And see, what I should have done is I should have done like this woman did with the issue of blood. She said, now, after she had not gotten any better with all of those things, she heard Jesus.
Yes.
She heard of Jesus. And when she heard of Jesus, she came and pressed behind and touched his garment.
Yes.
Now, it was right there that the Lord showed me something about this woman. And what he showed me was that she was in the press.
Yeah.
And when she was in the press, she had already decided, I gotta touch Jesus.
Amen.
She said, I got to touch Jesus. Because if I, she said, I had already, she had already determined in her mind, if I could just but touch his garment. His garment. She had already decided, I don't need him to, you know, to lay his hands on me. I don't need him to, you know, exactly, say some words to me to encourage me, sister, thy behold. She said, if I could but touch the hem of his garment, I'd be made whole.
Yes.
And she did. She touched him.
Amen.
But she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, being who he is, the all-knowing God that he is, the all-omnipresent God, knowing himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes?
Praise God.
Who touched me? Now, truth be told, he already knew who touched him.
Amen.
He is, because he's all-knowing. He knew who touched him.
Amen.
But what he tries to get us to understand is who he is.
Yes.
So that when you're reaching out trying to touch him, you know who he is.
Yes.
Hmm, sounds kind of contradictory, don't you? A little bit. But you got to know within yourself who Jesus is.
Yes.
Too many times we come out here, we try to encourage the people about who Jesus is. But first, you got to know within yourself who Jesus is.
Yes.
I can talk to you, I can preach to you, I can teach to you, I can say every manner of word to you, I can give you book upon book upon book. But until you know who Jesus is for yourself, you don't know him.
Yes.
You don't. It's just like each one of us. I don't know you until I get to know you.
Amen.
I got to know you first. I got to get to know you. And how do I get to know you? I get to know you by spending time with you or around you.
Yes.
To know who you are. To know what you're about. To know what you stand for. To know what you do and what you can't do. What my limitations are. What I can and cannot do. That's how I learn who you are.
Yes.
But this young lady, she had already determined in her mind, I know who Jesus is. I'm going to get through this crowd. I'm going to push through this crowd. I'm going to get what I need from Jesus. And I don't care who's standing in my way.
That's right.
I don't care who I got to knock out of my way, who I got to push out of my way. I don't care who I got to cut off. I don't care who I got to say bye-bye to.
Amen.
I got to get to Jesus, because that's the most important thing to me. Yes. I got to save myself.
Yes. Amen.
And that same mentality of saving yourself is the same mentality you need to have today when it comes to your spiritual salvation. You've got to save yourself.
Amen.
Now, going back to my story about when I was growing up and I got caught up in that situation. See, I didn't understand at the time when I was hanging out with my friends and my friends was getting me into situations that I couldn't get out of by myself, that I needed to save myself.
Yes.
A lot of people on these streets don't understand that. They might be hanging out with their friends drinking. They may be hanging out with their friends smoking. They may just be hanging out because those are the people they grew up with. But they got to understand, you've got to save yourself.
Yes.
Amen. That's right. You understand every man for yourself. You understand when it gets really tight. When it gets really tight,
yes.
And I'll put it to you plain and simple, and your life's on the line,
all right now,
who you gonna save? Yourself.
Yeah.
That's the first rule of human preservation. Save yourself.
Yes.
You ain't gonna be willing to lay down your life for nobody else until you get Jesus in your life.
Amen.
Because guess what? He was the example to us first. He didn't come to me saying, yo, man, you know what? Before I'm going to do something for you, you got to do something for me.
Sure did.
He didn't come to me like that.
Thank God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Just like some of these dudes out here on the street be doing. Yo, partner, I need you to do this for me. You do this for me and show me that you in or down with us. Then you know what? I'll let you, you know, step around. You know, you can come on into the crew or the group. No, Jesus don't ask us for that kind of proof.
That's right.
He don't ask us for that kind of commitment. The only commitment he asks of us is that we live for him.
Yes.
And allow him to be our personal savior. That's his commitment to us. He's trying to pull us out of the multitude. He's trying to pull us out of the crowd. He's trying to set us aside and put us in a place where he can use us so that we can be that example to those out there in the multitude to say, guess what? You can come out of the multitude. You ain't got to be out there with all of them doing all those things. You can come out. Be separate.
Yes.
Be different.
Yes.
Ain't nothing wrong with being different.
Amen.
So, back to my story. So after I came out of the situation, we came out, you know, went to jail. I was like, man, me, little me, high to a grasshopper in jail. Seriously, y'all, I want to say I was like 12 years old, somewhere around there. I wasn't even a teenager. And I'm in jail. All I know is I was young. I can't remember. I was just young. I'm like, here I am in jail. And I'm looking around the cell, and I'm like, oh my goodness. Nah. Today, you know, I got a little weight on me as time has passed by. You know, I got a little bit bigger, you know. There you go. Back then, I was good to be a 145 wet. Skin and bones. I'm up in this jail cell and I'm looking at these grown men around me. I'm like, oh my goodness. Man.
Mama.
Man. No, I wasn't crying no mama. I wasn't crying no mama. I was just like, man. I did that self-reflection, you know. You know, you see it in the movies, you see it in the programs too. This is a true thing. This is a true thing. When you in jail, you do a serious self-reflection. You start going back and forth over your life. Now look, mine wasn't that long anyway at the time. I'm going back over for my life. Oh my God, what did I do when I was in the fourth grade? What did I do when I was in the third grade? That was my experience. I hadn't even started to do nothing in life. And here I am reflecting on my life. And you know.